So here's Nishant Arya from JBM, please.
So very good afternoon. And today we have the pleasure of having Varsha Joshi ji with us and guiding us through this forum and really enlightening us. And a lot of friends from the industry, from Europe and other parts of the world who are experts in different parts of the EV mobility ecosystem. So what I'm sharing, a EV mobility perspective which we see in India. So as you see that the biggest challenge why we are talking about EV is air pollution, because air pollution is creating a big hazard in terms of the environment issues we are having all over the country and the health challenges. And transportation is one of the biggest contributors to this air pollution which we see today. And the initiatives which were taken by cities like Delhi about a decade ago, CNG were very fruitful at that time, but now many such new more initiatives are required to be taken all over the country, like renewable energy and including in transportation, electric vehicles and many more. If we talk about electric vehicles, our target is not only electric vehicles, target is zero emission vehicles. For zero emission vehicles, there are multiple technologies where electric vehicles is the most promising technology today, and that's why we are talking about electric vehicles. If we compare different kind of vehicles in multiple categories, if we talk about passenger cars, three-wheelers, two-wheelers, the eventual idea is to see that how are we talking about well-to-wheel perspective eventually, and if I break it up into two parts, well-to-tank and tank-to-wheel. And a well-to-tank, the idea is that since our country is embarking on such a big renewable energy journey, which is about 175 gigawatt of renewable energy in next 5 years, 4 years, out of which a large part could be taken up by the electric vehicles for charging. And the tank to wheel perspective definitely gets answered with this if we are going for electric vehicles, and the SOx, NOx as well as the CO2 goes down drastically in case of BEVs, battery electric vehicles. The idea is here that we are not talking only about OEMs or charging manufacturers or auto component companies.
Nishant, may I interrupt you for a second?
Yes.
Ma'am would like to leave, so sorry, on behalf of the organizers, I'll have a small memento.
Thank you so much. Thank you. I'll leave it for you.
Thank you for your presence, ma'am. So in the electric mobility ecosystem, we really see that all the key stakeholders need to be there with us, as these are all key wheels and pillars of the industry. And eventually, electric mobility has to go to all the key segments of transportation to reach, have the last mile connectivity and reach in each and every individual. The idea here is that the key components of EV, whether it is battery, motors, converters, I'll talk about more, many more of them as we go forward, are important to get localized to bring the cost down and make it affordable. Similarly, for any user, it's essential that the charging infrastructure is available and is understood by the person, because the operating pattern for any user changes in electric vehicle compared to a conventional fuel vehicle. And at the same time, we see that like our government is focusing primarily on public transportation today, about 70 to 80% of the funds are going to public transportation. So that would be a prime focus, since it is having a defined operating pattern there, whether we talk about the government or operating companies like Ola's, Uber's, taxis and many other areas need to understand how EV operates. So the whole ecosystem needs to operate together. Certain key things, if we see in Europe, how they started mainly with plug-in hybrids initially and are moving on to battery electric vehicles. Similarly, multiple Japanese OEMs like Nissan and Toyota have been the leaders of electric mobility in the passenger car segment, as well as many US OEMs are moving slowly, but they are not seeing this as a prime focus as on date. But many countries, if we see, like Netherlands, France, Norway, even Japan and China, they have adopted electric mobility in a very big way, and seen that, like in Amsterdam, there are multiple areas, they have more than 1800 chargers which are deployed, and parking lots are free for people who are using electric vehicles. So they're incentivizing the people to really go for electric, and different technologies like battery swapping for smaller vehicles, as well as the localization of the whole supply chain is a very important part for electric vehicles to become affordable. And the idea is everything would coexist eventually, whether we talk about battery electric vehicles, plug-in hybrids, and the whole ecosystem would operate together. But very important is that how are we bringing all these stakeholders together? If we talk about stakeholders, the perspective is that eventual target, as we understood, is health, is environment. How are they able to improve quality of life for all their citizens in the city and the country at large? How is a transport operator able to get a holistic purview with maintenance, efficiencies, infrastructure challenges which they have? The DISCOMs in India are playing a very important role because electricity can't be sold by anybody. You need a proper license from the government, and there is a system which is there. Even though government is thinking about changing and evolving that, but until then, DISCOMs and many other companies would be playing a very key role in supporting the charging infra across the country and the OEMs for manufacturing and supplying the vehicles. And as we heard one of the gentlemen talking some time back, that the OEMs and many other players in the ecosystem are not being considered as only vehicle suppliers. That's why I've used this word as vehicle suppliers only here, not OEMs, because the larger responsibility, because the common man, a layman, does not understand the EV space very well, so he needs a lot of support in his day-to-day operations and working to get that comfort and get out of the range anxiety. In many cases, people have that range anxiety: what will happen to my vehicle, where the vehicle would stop, how things would operate at that point, what would I do? So there are certain key policy trends which in India we can clearly adopt, we can benchmark with, where international cities, we are seeing many governments are funding, they are coming out with state-sponsored programs, they're targeting fleets, zero-emission fleets. But I think what is acting in a much better way is inhibitors. In inhibitors, where the government is mandating a percentage of any commercial fleet to be electric, at the same time there are emission-free zones where only electric vehicles can ply, or there are higher taxes. Like in our case, our government always has a perspective of taking a leap forward, whether we talk from BS4 to BS6, whether we saw in the telecom space, and even now in electric, where the government has tried to jump over from the conventional fuel to electric without going to hybrid. So I think that kind of a perspective, and the GST of 43% on hybrid is a testimony to that fact, that the government wants a citizen of the country to focus on electric vehicles only. But most important is how are we able to bring about a right TCO, a total cost of ownership. Definitely we start from the top left quadrant where government talks about proactive government shift, push towards it. Then there is a bit of a status quo because people are in a limbo. They want to understand what is electric, how would it operate, what will happen, how will I use this vehicle. Then the market drives such kind of vehicles. But if we move the top right quadrant where the government support and the TCO attractiveness really drives the customer, so then it becomes a win-win situation for everybody, like what happened with solar 6-7 years ago, 8 years ago, and today it is cheaper than conventional power. I personally see that electric mobility is on the same path. So here we have taken a small example of BEVs, where we see that in a economic rationale, since India is a cost-sensitive market, so where we talk about, let's say, a hatchback of about 0.55 million rupees and going to about 0.8 million rupees in case of EV hatchback, so the cost is higher by about 0.25 million, but the operating running cost is 15% of a conventional vehicle. So the vehicle can't be the same vehicle for each and every customer. It has to be customized. Because if I see where the customer is having a very high consumption pattern, the payback is less than a year, whereas in the worst case, it is going up to even 6 years. So battery size can't be fixed. As you heard few of the previous speakers talking, the dead weight of the battery is pretty high. So we need to see how the vehicles are becoming lighter, the payload, the passenger capacity is being enhanced. But definitely, there are multiple challenges which we have here. Whether it is charging turnaround time, battery efficiency, vehicle performance, resale value, because that is a big part for any customer to see. And moreover, in today's scenario, model choices, because he needs to have multiple models used from every company, may come out with one or two models in a certain space. That does not give comfort to the customer that he has made a choice of what he could buy. It is something which is forced upon him. So the key factors here are really important, like we see in the battery space. Even though other aspects are very important, but eventually the right technology for the application and the recycling part is very essential. What would happen with the end of life perspective? Are we talking about energy storage applications there? In case of customer concerns, how is the range anxiety being met? If we talk about the charging infra, what kind of business models would emerge? What kind of norms are there? So many new players from different domains are getting into charging infra and the electric mobility, like real estate and logistics. People who don't understand the automotive part at all, but we see that they would be a good contributor since they have properties and a network across the country where charging infrastructure would be installed. Similarly, companies coming from the energy background who understand high voltage very well would be good contributors. Companies coming from the automotive space who understand how vehicles are made are good contributors. So people coming from all walks of life, definitely correlated areas can add value. And one thing which is definitely there, as we move from BS4 to BS6, vehicles will become costlier. And as vehicles become costlier, by then the battery prices would go down, localization would go up. So we would be definitely close to parity. I would not say we'd achieve parity, but quite close to parity. Here are some very good opportunities we see for component players. Since in India, most of these things are not being manufactured, a lot of this can be made. Big companies can take up many of these things. Batteries account for about 45% to 50% of any vehicle cost today. Power electronics are a key aspect of the whole value chain, even electric motors. And moreover, other than the components, I would like to talk about the service offerings. Service offerings like battery leasing, battery financing, after life usage, recycling, the testing, charging services, architecture design. I think all these are inevitable parts of the whole value chain, how companies can utilize these models. And these models would not be specific to a company or to a location. I think they would be different across the country, as every city has a different challenge, different demographic, geographic, and the citizens of the city are requiring different services. But definitely, as we move forward, personally speaking, I see that it will be a phased localization plan, battery being the largest component. I have tried to highlight that. So if you see here, the battery pack and BMS being the first phase, battery modules the second, and battery cells the third. In that perspective, it should move. At the same time, I think I would not talk, a lot of my colleagues have already spoken of the international market. So, but the bigger picture is public transportation, what Indian market is looking at. So in this, we talk about the e-auto, the e-rickshaw, taxis, and intra-city buses. Intercity buses in most of the countries across the world do not use electric as much, since the cost, the viability, and TCO is not as effective. So if we compare to diesel, in a European environment or American environment, the bus would have about 71% benefit vis-a-vis a diesel bus. Whereas in an Indian environment where we do have certain challenges, I would take it as 42% based on the particulate matter, the cost, the TCO perspective, and the energy efficiency. But what's more important is how are we able to bring about a perspective with green energy, autonomous driving, and connected vehicles, because all three are interconnected. In many cases, we see people see them separately, but they go hand in hand. As in Shenzhen also, we have seen many cases where the government has decided to go for about 100% electric fleet in buses. In Europe, operators and technology companies like Keolis, Navya have deployed their structures across France, Norway, Netherlands, and many other cities. And in the connected vehicles also, what is essential for any customer today is that seamless information. How you have connected devices, your iPhone or Android or any other device which you are using at any point in time, how information flows seamlessly. So that is going to be very, very important. And the connectivity between two vehicles and many other things would really be the need of the hour. At the same time, we need to be really careful. In certain cases, multiple companies I see in our neighboring countries and other locations are looking at very, very high voltage electricals in a very simplified manner. So we need to deal with them with care. The batteries on vehicles need to be reduced to really see that we are only using what is optimally required. Infrastructure shortage is there, which needs to be taken care of. And the energy storage, which is seen as a very, very in a simplified manner, that is a very complicated subject which needs to be addressed. So any company in the ecosystem, whichever role one plays, needs to see it in a very, very careful manner, addressing all the needs. At the same time, the charging infra, whether we talk of fast charging or overnight charging, it has an impact on the battery technology. So both of them are interlinked, but definitely a lot of evolution has to still take place in the battery technology in the next 5 to 7 years, how battery prices are going down, how in Europe they see that manganese is also catching up as a focus area, because 70% of the lithium reserves are with one country across the world, and or they control it. So I think it will be very interesting times how where we talk about ultra capacitors, super capacitors, other technologies or battery technologies. The time would tell which technology would have the where with it all to move forward. At the same time, seeing how the bus is panning out across the globe, we see that in China there is a huge demand. About 116,000 buses are already sold. Many cities are following Shenzhen model and going for electric. Similarly, in Europe, even though the number of buses are small, but for as a percentage of their total buses, a lot would change in the upcoming years. But in India, with the FAME scheme, in the 11 cities which have come out, a lot of things are moving. Similarly, in smart cities, many smart cities have got adequate funds to take actions. I think that will propel a lot of growth and will give opportunities to all players in the ecosystem. This is a personal estimate based on the current market that about 60% market of electric in China and 30% in India in next 7 years, annual production of 100,000 electric buses by then, and 10% for rest of the world is what would be the average in my scenario, in my perspective. Yeah. But it's very important that we see what kind of business models are emerging. So in business model, we see whether it's OEM city or technology player in city or multiple OEMs with infrastructure providers in a city are giving certain models across different cities. Here I have taken examples of Middle East and Europe, where the OEMs as well as the city administrations have been quite forthcoming towards electric vehicles. So a fixed model would not work. A customized model based on the city requirement really would operate from city to city, country to country. How the bus prices or in public transportation prices have dropped down, the driving range is getting established more or less in a certain way, but definitely the Bharat 6, which is based on the Euro 6, would be a benefit in this case as the cost would go up otherwise for conventional buses and or other conventional vehicles as such, so that would reduce the parity between the vehicles, as well as the autonomous driving and the green what I spoke of would get included into this, and the reduction in battery cost and enhancement in TCO would be a big benefit. But all these things would rely on certain key factors like government subsidies to start with for a few years, like China is now subsiding its subsidy program in the next 3 years, then it is wanting the industry to come up on its own. But what is important for the society at large is that how are we making public transport a choice, not a necessity? What we see in many cities in Europe, in Japan or other countries, that who's who across the society, people are using public transport as a choice, whether it's a metro or it's a bus or any product. So in India today, that's not the case for many people. So the public transport should be such that everybody wants to use it. And definitely it is one of the best modes of transport for them. Catering to certain cities as an intra-city product, whether it is three-wheelers, it is buses, it is metro, whichever application it may be. And it is affordable for people, eventually that's what we are looking for as well. But this is the approach which we follow as an organization, which we call the JBM ecosystem approach. And in this ecosystem, whether we talk, here we have taken an example of buses, but it would be true for any and every domain. Whether we talk about as an OEM for or key aggregates, power, transmission, distribution, charging infra, intelligent transportation systems, operation and maintenance. So any customer wants a 360-degree solution, end-to-end solution in this case, because that's what's most important to remove the customer anxiety and ensure the performance of the product. And that's where you are taking that risk and banking on your own product to give that service. So it's not a bus manufacturer or a key aggregate manufacturer, it's an ecosystem solution provider. That's how we position ourselves. And our company is called JBM Solaris Electric Vehicles. We are seeing that with 100% electric, with zero emission, we save about 350,000 liters of diesel and about 1,000 tons of CO2. So this is what I wanted to share with all of you, trying to give a perspective what that we are looking forward to in India. Thanks a lot. Thank you.